Hello, good evening, everybody. I hope you are doing okay. Very nice to see you all. I know we are a couple of minutes late. I'm seeing the people are coming in now. I can already see 16 participants in the room. Let's wait a minute more and then we'll start. In the meanwhile, I see Mariam, your hand is up. If you want to ask anything, you can write it in the chat box, please. So let's wait one more minute and then we'll start the session, okay? I see Nibal's hand is up. Nibal, if you have any question, please feel free to write it in the chat box. Nice to know you, Noor. You're from Indonesia. That's great to know. Okay, so let's start. Maybe Mr. Anand is here. He will write you in the chat box how the attendance will be taken. Everyone, very nice to see you all. I am very excited to see all these high school students here. And this is great to be together. To be able to talk about a very, very important issue, that is empathy and how to build empathy. And not only, you know, how to build empathy, but also that how do we use empathy and build empathy for a better world? And that's the title of the seminar, webinar, right? So I would ask Ms. Fedha to share with us the link for the mentee. Already she has shared. Is as you can see in the chat box, there is a link to the mentee. If you can please all get it ready, because there are many, many places where you will be required to answer the questions, and we will be using our Mentimeter for the responses. All right. So everyone, I'll give you a minute to log into to this Mentimeter, and then we will start. And in the meanwhile, I'll request Ms. Fedha to share the screen, please. Fantastic. Thank you so much, Vedam. Okay. So here we start. Let's start talking about a concept of building empathy for a better world, right? Let's go to the next slide and I will ask you a question. Yes, this is my first question and I want everybody to use a chat box and tell me, what do you see in this picture? What is the most prominent thing that you see in the picture? Can you write it in the chat box? Yes, Siti says it's a blue lobster. Wonderful, Siti. That's a great response. I also saw the blue lobster the first. But Hussam says it's a group of crabs and lobsters, Nibal is saying. Absolutely. So we all see many, many lobsters. We see crabs here in this picture. But let's go with this blue lobster thing. And let's say that this is the most prominent feature that you see in this picture. Yeah, you also see orange lobsters. That's absolutely right, Jannat. But let's talk about the blue lobster. Anybody knows anything about blue lobster? Any special thing about blue lobsters? Why do you think blue lobsters are very, very rare? Or what do you see here? Okay, yeah, they're rare species. That's right, Siti. I like what you're saying, is that they are the rare species. Do you know how rare? Can you tell me how rare they are in terms of numbers? How many lobsters do we have? And then we get only one blue lobster. Any guess? You can write it in the chat box. 1%, Hussam is saying. I don't know that now the total population of lobsters, so I don't know what 1% will mean, but research says that every 2 million lobsters, only one comes out as blue lobsters. Yeah, out of 2 million lobsters, only one is blue lobster. And last time they found in Maryland somewhere, you know, and it was a big news on the National Geographic Channel and all these other places, you know, where they say, so, and they're very expensive. They're very rare, they're very expensive. It says that, you know, it costs like $500 to get one blue lobster, you know, the rare cases, you know, the special ones. So very expensive and very, very rare. You can only find 2 million, you can only find one lobster in 2 million lobsters. This is an amazing thing, right? Now, I want to relate this with this understanding of people. So we as human being, let's say, who is the, so here we see that, you know, blue lobster is a prominent one because you only find one in 2 million and you find these blue lobsters, you know, which are very expensive and they're special ones and all. If I ask you this question, that if you relate this example with human being, who are the special ones in today's time? Who are the most unique ones in today's time? What would you write it in the chat box? And what kind of people, you know, are the most special one and the unique one? And okay, famous people, maybe politicians, as Sam is saying, that's right. Okay, let's see the next. Okay, depends on the society. Yeah, that's right. I know I'm also laughing like you that, you know, politicians are the ones. Let's see who are the ones who are the unique ones. Who are the ones who are making difference in the world? The minority ones, Siti is saying, right? Okay, let's see the next slide. So if you can go to the next slide. And what I want you to do is here, is that use your Mentimeter. Now you've logged in the Mentimeter and you can already see the first question there. And the question is, what are some characteristics of blue lobsters in today's time? So if we call ourselves as blue lobster, the rare one, or if you call somebody as blue lobster, that he is like a blue lobster, what are some of the qualities that you think are admirable or something which you really think that, you know, makes him or her different from others? Okay, I like what Tanzil is saying, that someone who makes others happy. So Tanzil, can you use the Mentimeter and write your responses there? So I will, yeah, okay, so I can see someone who is more human, okay. The people who are different from others and has things that makes them special from others. Absolutely, this is a very, very good answer. Mm-hmm. I like what Andrea is saying, that the one who can adapt, the one who can learn new skills. Yes, those are the blue lobsters of today's time. That's right. Literally, I don't know, Mariam, what exactly you mean. Mariam, you can write it in the chat box, in the Menti, to explain your answer more. Mm-hmm. What else? Who else is the blue lobster in? Tell me. Any other responses? Okay, the scientist one. All right, Mariam is saying the scientists are the blue lobsters of today's time. Okay, so let's go to responses that we have received already, right? So people saying the one who are more human, or the one who are making difference to in others' life. Now, this is a very, very important point that, you know, you are saying here. Andrea is saying that gifted kids are the blue lobsters, right? Somebody who is making a difference in others' life. So today we are going to learn here, how can we make difference in somebody's life? What is the first step in making a difference in somebody's life? What can you and I do so we became more human, as somebody's saying? Or we are able to, you know, make somebody happy or bring a smile on somebody's face or do something which can lead to a better world. And that's exactly what we are going to learn here, right? So let's go to the next slide. Here, we will talk here about these two pictures that you can see. And I want to ask you, what do you see here? What are these people doing here? In the chat box, what are they doing here? Yeah, okay, they're brushing. Thank you, Sam. They're brushing their teeth, right? And we all brush our teeth. I hope you do. Right? Some people do two times in a day. Some people forget at night. But we still do. We still brush our teeth, right? Yes, Siti, you can relate it what I'm saying, right? That some people, only rinsing is fine. You know, too long to brush teeth. But in anyhow, yeah? So now these people brushing their teeth. And it is a routine. So we all have a routine that we wake up in the morning and we take our toothbrush in our hand, we put the toothpaste on the brush and we brush our teeth, right? No thinking is going on at the time. I mean, we are almost zombies. So of course nothing is going on at the time, but we are able to kind of, you know, do it because it has become our routine, right? So my question to you is that there are two kinds of thinking. One is the conscious thinking, and I will use the word design thinking for that. And that has become a very popular way of doing it. Alia, you for the Mentimeter, Ms. Fedha has put the link in the chat up there. So please click the link and you will be able to get your Mentimeter. Yeah, you don't need a code. So let's write your answers here on the Mentimeter. What is the difference between routine thinking and design thinking? So design thinking, I said, where you are conscious of that I want to bring a smile on somebody's face. So I would like to hear from you that what is the difference between routine thinking and design thinking? Ms. Fedha, if you can put the code of Mentimeter on the chat box, because some of the students are saying they cannot log in via the link that you have posted. So if you have the code, if you can please put it in the chat box. In the meanwhile, others can write, what do you think is the routine thinking and what do you think is design thinking? So you already have a question on the Mentimeter. Can you please log in and write your response there? Okay, Ms. Fedha has put the code on the chat box. If in case any one of you is unable to join through the link, you can use this code to join in. So what is a routine thinking? Anybody can respond to me? I haven't received any responses, by the way, on this Menti yet. Okay, if you're unable to write it on the Menti, don't worry, just write it in the chat box. I'm reading your chat box as well. Okay, somebody said on the Menti that routine thinking is that we do on a daily basis. That's right, okay. So routine thinking, okay. Somebody said the routine thinking is when the things you usually do and are in your subconscious mind. The design thinking is when you're aware of what you are doing step by step. Excellent answer. This is an excellent answer. Routine thinking is something that we do daily without planning. Design thinking is the things that we need to have a plan to do it. Innovation comes out in design thinking. Excellent. This is absolutely brilliant answer. Yes, absolutely. So look at some of the examples. Yeah. Ayat is saying that limited thinking is a routine thinking. Look at some examples. You know, I gave you the example of toothpaste and a brush, right? We all brush our teeth in the morning. It is our routine. Nobody has ever thought about it, you know, how can I do it differently? I mean, come on, this is too early in the morning to think about it. You know, how can I do it differently, right? Now, we all have been doing it for last, you are 15 years, 18 years old student sitting here. You are doing it for last so many years. I'm 40 years. I have been doing this, you know, for 40 years. We never question this, but somebody somewhere thought about it and they said, what can be done to make this experience of brushing teeth better? What can we do to make sure that, you know, the people who have arthritis, their teeth are not hurt by brushing the teeth? Or somebody must have thought, how can we make this process pleasant and faster and easier? And whoever did this and whoever written is the answer, innovation in design thinking, that's where the innovation came in. So when they start putting their conscious thinking, I like the word, you know, that, you know, subconscious, and I'm assuming that you are saying that, you know, when you do conscious thinking, it's conscious approach. Now in doing that, It allowed me to come out of my thinking box, to come out of my routine and do something which is out of the box, which people don't do it. And there comes your electronic toothbrush, right? Here comes your toothbrush with lights for the kids. Here comes toothbrush with the music. So children who just, you know, when they get their teeth, fresh new teeth, and they start brushing their teeth, they are excited about it. In order to add excitement, there are toothbrush which are with the music in it. There are toothbrush which are there with the lights in it. There are electronic toothbrush. You don't have to brush manually, you know. You know, it is such a painful process to brush manually, right? So let's come up with something which is different. So they came up with a process which is machine-based. I'll give you one more example. Yes, I like, Fatima, what you said, that it is outside the box thinking. I'll give you one more example. Let's say car driving. We all drive our car, right? We have been driving it for years and years and years, and we have never thought about anything. It is our routine. We come out, we go to our car, we open the door, we sit in the car, we put the steering on, we drive. We drive sometimes for hours and hours. People who drive from Al Ain to Abu Dhabi or Dubai to Abu Dhabi or Abu Dhabi to Dubai, now Oman, all this, you know, we drive hours and hours and hours. Did you ever think that how can this experience get better? Who thought about it? Who is a popular person today thinking about this? And how can we make the driving experience better? Can I have the name in the chat box quickly? Who talk about it? The cars can be electronic. The cars can be self-driven. The cars doesn't need drivers now, you know, it can go automatic. And therefore, yes, like Tesla, absolutely. Yeah. So Elon Musk kind of people came up with the thinking outside the box and said, something needs to be done to make this experience better. Because thousands and thousands of people spend hours and hours on the road. There are traffic jam, there are frustration, there's smoke, there is all this troubles that people have on the road and accidents, and therefore this needs a safe approach. Therefore, they came up with the idea and said, something needs to be done. Now, in both the cases, if you saw in the toothpaste case and in the car case, in both the examples, you saw that I did not talk only about innovation, but I talked about the pain points. In the first example, I said that the pain point is that people facing difficulty in the gums, it is too hard to brush in the morning. I talked that arthritis patients have difficulty brushing their teeth. Based on this empathy, based on this, that I put my foot in your shoes and feel the pain what you go through, I came up with a design called, you know, innovation. Even in the car example, I came up with the idea thinking that too many accidents, too much smoke, frustration, too much time on the road, something needs to be done. So that element where I'm trying to understand the pain point, that is what is empathy. Okay, so we'll go and see it further in detail. So let's go to the next slide, Feather. Okay, so the next slide that talks about what is empathy, yeah? It talks about, so empathy is putting yourself in others' position and feeling the pain of the people, what people feel, what they experience. And once you do it, sometimes you have to do it. There are many, many ways of doing it. We will learn one method today to build empathy. But you know, whenever you want to build empathy, it is important that you see what people are doing. You hear what people are saying. You observe what people go through. You listen to their stories. Yeah. and you tell them that, you know, and you hear from them that what do they go through. And based on that, you know, you feel the pain that what they go through. So for example, I will, yes, to put yourself in their shoes, absolutely, Siti. So to, for example, you know, fresh graduates come to university and very soon you will be in the university, right? When you will go, you reach to the class late. What happened? Why are you late? University. Because all of students like you who are used to a small school campus and a hand-holding approach by your teachers and by your coordinators and admin staff and everybody, now you are in your own world of university, right? Because when fresh graduates come, you know, they don't find the classroom. The campus is too big, right? Everywhere you need to log in, you know, there's no person sitting there. Everything is automatic online. So you have your punch card, you punch your card and you will be able to enter the door, right? Now, all these things that the students go through are the pain points which everybody faces and you will also face it. So be prepared for that, all right? I'm not scaring you, by the way. I'm just giving you an example. I, as an observer, I talk to you and tell you, okay, Siti, tell me what happened on the first day. So Siti will tell me, oh, I went to university, my bus dropped me on one gate, and then I realized that my classrooms were on totally on the opposite side. It took me 15 minutes to reach there. When I reached there, my classroom section was not the one where I was supposed to go. I was on the other side, all this pain, you know. So that tells me, that story of Siti tells me, what did she go through in order to, you know, do something to improve her experience, right? So I develop insights. Once I develop insights, I develop concepts then. So I'll say, that means the campus is too big for the fresh graduates, or the signage is missing for, you know, for the guidance, let's say, yeah? Or there is not this much longer, you know, distance between two classes. So a student who has a class in section, you know, in X floor, now the student has to have to go in Y floor. It takes 10 minutes to reach there, which we do not have in between. So I'm developing concepts. And once I develop the concepts, then it will lead me to design something, to innovate something, to make your experience better. So now when you go to the university, you will see there is a guiding map, for example, or there are mentors who will guide you, or there are securities who are responsible for each floor. So these are innovative solutions that, you know, people come up with based on understanding of what people go through and what they experience. Without understanding of what people go through, it is very difficult to design something to make your experience better, right? Otherwise, I'll design anything, but that is not solving your problem. So if I want to solve your problem, the only way is to build empathy, to put myself in your position and say, oh, how hard it must be for the fresh graduates to cope in a new environment, which is very different than the school environment. And that understanding will lead me to develop and design something for you to make your experience better. Okay? Can we turn our empathy into something practical? Absolutely, and we are going to do it now. Okay, so let's change the slide. Let's go to the next slide. And I want you to now, based on my explanation to you, now write it in this Mentimeter. What is empathy in your opinion? How would you describe empathy in your words? I already have few definitions in the chat box, and I would give time to other people to start writing in the Mentimeter. What is empathy? Yeah, Ms. Feda has already put the link on the chat, and there is a code also given. Just go menti.com and write 737545 and you will be able to answer this. Tell me in one word or in one sentence, what is empathy? Dr. Huneeda, I see your hand is up. You want to speak here? Okay, so somebody has written here, feeling same emotions. Yes, absolutely, that is empathy. Feeling the same emotion of what person is feeling. Okay, more responses? Okay, here we go, so many. Okay, wonderful. To feel what happens. Empathy is like you try feeling sad to others, okay? Okay, to feel what happens to others. I think this others is a part of the upper point, okay? Feeling sad to others, to feel what happens to others, feeling the same emotions. If you are unable to connect with mentee, don't worry, just write it in the chat box. I am looking at both the things together. Yeah? Okay, anything else that you think you would like to write here about what is empathy? Yeah, so these are some very, very important answers, absolutely. Somebody said here, understanding the feelings of others, yes, absolutely. To be able to support others, yes, you will be able to support others by understanding their pain points. Feeling sorry for someone, maybe empathy. I want to make one point on the point that somebody has said, so it's feeling sorry for someone. There are two words. One is feeling sympathy and one is feeling empathy. There's one word is empathy and one word is sympathy. Sympathy is that feeling sorry for, oh my goodness, oh my God, you have to face this. That is sympathy, right? I feel sorry for you. But empathy, in my opinion and my perspective, your perspective may be different. My perspective, empathy is a genuine perspective and approach to understand somebody's experience to improve that situation. That is empathy. So empathy leads to improvement. Sympathy only gives you somebody to cry with, or someone gives you shoulder to cry on. That's it, right? So I'm feeling sympathetic about, oh my God, I feel so sorry. Oh, you did not have money to eat your lunch today. Oh my God, this is really sad. But that's sympathy. But empathy is that when I put myself in your position and say, oh my God, what does it mean to have no money in the pocket to eat your food? And being able to help the person out to improve the experience. And that is the power of empathy. Yeah, and you will see the power of empathy in a while. We are going to watch something amazing about it. Understanding the feelings. Yes, absolutely. Feeling sad to others, putting yourself in the same situation. Absolutely. So let's go to the next slide. Dr. Huneeda, I agree with you that put yourself in the same situation. I think that's absolutely what empathy is all about, right? So we are talking about there how empathy is putting us in, you know, we put ourselves in other situations so we are able to help the person improve their experience by coming out with some innovation, some design thinking, some kind of thing. So here we say empathy is a noun. The action of understanding, you rightly mention it in your responses, being aware of and being sensitive to and vigorously experiencing the feelings, thoughts and experience of others. And I think that's exactly what you said. So I don't want to explain this anymore because you already said it. It is being able to understand the other situation, being able to be aware of what the person is going through, being sensitive to what they are doing and what their thoughts are and their experiences of others. Okay, so I think so far we are clear here what is empathy. Yeah, so let's talk more about it. Let's go to the next slide. Yeah, so here increasing, now today in this, why do you think the word empathy is so popular today? Why this empathy was not needed, you know, maybe 50 years before, let's say. Why people never talked about empathy and why people are talking about empathy now? Why do you think that empathy is important now in this today's 21st century, in today's 24th December 2020. Tell me why in this time period, empathy is so important. Can you write it in the chat box? So today we live in the most diverse societies in the history. Never in the history people lived in such diverse multicultural society, such globalized society. Today, the time that we are living in, because yes, absolutely, Hussam is saying, because there is so much of diseases. Look at the exchange, look at this COVID, yeah? Look at, Meera is saying that empathy allows us to be able to understand people's background and upbringings, absolutely. So this is something which is important, that today we live in a very globalized, multicultural world where interaction of one person to another person is the fastest in the history. We never had this time in the history before where we had such interaction of this fast, rapid way. And when I say interaction, it is not only face-to-face interaction. It is the interaction that we have on using the digital medium. So the process and the cultural exchange that happens in today's time is a rapid way. It is a manner that has never happened in the history before. And therefore, in order to deal with different people, it is important that we deal with different perspectives, different understanding, different pain points of people. What people go through when they come from the country of war, let's say. What do people feel when there are natural disasters? What do people feel when they come from a culture where they're a minority? All these aspects lead us to understand what do they go through, and therefore it shapes our behavior differently. Yeah. Siti saying, because I think our generation today has a lot of problems, especially in today's society, such as war, racism, sexism. Absolutely, Siti, you have said it, you have hit the nail right on the head. Because nowadays we are an open society and community. Noor agrees with you. I also agree with you. Okay, so let's move on. Let's move on to the next slide. So far we have developed a sound understanding of what is empathy and why empathy is important. Okay, I want to introduce two words to you here. One is called emic and one is called ethic. I don't know whether you have ever heard this. Yes, I like, Maryam, what you're saying, that today information transmitted is so fast. And therefore, we need to know, we need to have that empathy for others to be able to understand what are they saying and why are they saying, yeah? Why are they making their perspective? So good point, Maryam. Okay, I want to talk here about perspective taking, yeah? Can anybody tell me what is the meaning of emic and what is the meaning of ethic? Here you go. So you have got one more Mentimeter to do. So go to the Mentimeter if you are not already there. Here Ms. Feather has already again put the 737545 in your chat box. Please write it down. What is the difference between emic and ethic? And have you ever heard this word before? If you cannot handle Menti, don't worry, just write it in the chat box. I'm happy to read it from here as well. You can quickly Google it if you have never heard this word before. Okay, somebody said, I really don't know. I really appreciate your candidness and your honesty. Thank you so much for saying that I don't know. Okay. Anybody else knows what is emic and what is ethic? Okay, different perspectives. Yes, Meera, you are right. This is all about different perspectives. I think both are steps for empathy. So emic is maybe observing and ethic is maybe the feeling. Absolutely brilliant. Whoever has written this second response, I really loved it. It is excellent. So both are about empathy. One is about observing and one is about the feeling. Study of culture. I'm not too sure about the study of culture, but I see where you're coming from. Maybe emic and ethic is about perspective taking, and that helps to study the culture. Between perspectives and actions, absolutely. So let me give you one example. Yeah. So what happens that, I have a routine. For example, I live okay, let me give you the example of women education. I think that is a better example. There was a time when parents never sent their girls to schools. They did not believe in girls' education. You remember that, right? Even in Arab culture, right? If you see the history of UAE or this crucial states where we are at, which was called this place was called crucial states, right? If you see the history, women were not going to school and it was fine for everybody, right? It was a pattern that, everybody was fine, that women, and the girl child was born. Pre-Islam was different. Pre-Islam, when the girl child was born, they would bury the girl child alive because it was a matter of shame. But after Islam, when Islam educated people, it became a norm that women would be in the house. Boys will go to school. They had those community schools and all, but girls will stay at home. Girls will stay at home, look after cooking and cleaning and get married and produce children and all this. That was a pattern, right? Nobody questioned it. That's how the lifestyle was. But then there came somebody and said, women should be going to school because that is the pillar of society development. Wow, nobody thought about it before. Nobody thought that, women can go to school as well. Because we live in a setting, we live in a situation which we are so used to of it, we don't see it that anything is wrong in that situation, right? Remember the earlier point we said routine? Because this becomes our lifestyle. We never think that, things can be done differently than this. And therefore, somebody who comes from outside will give you the perspective and say, look, women can go to school. And there was the first father who said, let me try. I should send my girl to school. And look at today's society where we are at with women education. The society would be incomplete if women education is not there, right? That is how the change comes in the societies. That is how society improves, that we are so used to of one pattern and then something, some other perspective, somebody else comes and says, you're doing this, but this is wrong. Early marriages, for example, people used to marry their girls at the age of 10 and 12. It was the norm of the society. Society functioned like this. But then somebody gave the separate outside perspective and said, women should not be married at the age of 10 and 12. They should study. They should, build their career and let them marry. And then by law, you cannot marry your girl by, I think 18 is the age in the UAE, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. So somebody is saying that emic is the feeling of relating and etic is approaching to something in conclusion. Both are the similar in some way. So now I think you understand what I mean. Dr. Hunita is saying that there is a term in Arabic for it. It says contact and separation. Beautiful, Dr. Hunita. Meaning do not let the situation control. Oh my goodness, I love it. I love what you're saying, Dr. Hunita. Thank you for bringing this perspective. I think you are absolutely, it's a brilliant response. That, she's saying there's a word in Arabic, and if you can write that Arabic word, Ms. Dr. Hunita, that would be great. Where she's saying that contact and separation, meaning do not let the situation control you. Because if we live in one situation, we are controlled by it. But then you need to break that situation and see how things can be done differently. Yeah? And look at the next slide, where I think I have she has written the Arabic word. It says, al-tasal and wala al-nafsal, if I'm reading it correctly. Sorry, my apologies for the bad Arabic, but it says al-tasal and wala nafsal. So look at this picture. Where is my picture, Feather? Maybe in the first previous slide. So there's a picture. There's a, if I ask the fish, if I ask the fish, How is water? You know, how is the water? So what will fish respond to me? Fish will say, what is water? Because she lives there, she has grew up in there, she swims there day and night. She doesn't know that, right? That what is water? It has become a lifestyle. Until and unless you take out the fish from the water, and then when fish will realize the outside environment and say, oh, I need water, right? So then she would be able to understand what water is. Similarly, we need to come out of our realities and see things differently and be able to understand the perspectives, which usually we ignore, which we usually, the perspective we don't see. We have a pattern and we are used to of that pattern. And we always do that. And we don't worry about thinking outside the box. We don't worry about ethic. We are so ingrained in EMIC that ethic is a story for us, which is never heard of. We never hear that story before, right? And that is what the meaning of EMIC and ethic, and that is the power of ethic, that ethic lets you see things which you are unable to see otherwise, right? For example, even Arabic food and even my food, you know, I come from an Asian background, subcontinent background, and you know that, you know, we use so much oil in our food. We are so used to, of, you know, putting, you know, you pour it like this. We don't see it, but then, because it is our pattern, we have been grown up like this, right? And therefore, you know, this picture, yeah, this one. Look at this fish. If you are living in one environment, you wouldn't be able to know what is outside unless somebody or something trigger you to see it outside. Then you will be able to see it. Dr. Runita, absolutely, you can speak. I will unmute yourself. I will try to unmute yourself. Allow to talk again. Dr. Runita, can you unmute yourself and once more?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, yes.
Yes, first, thank you. And I'm happy about this issue, and it is really very nice. I want to read it in Arabic. Al-ittisal wal-infisal.
Al-ittisal, al-infisal.
And because, you know, something now, when we are watching the television and the news, all the news now, it is, unfortunately, it is negative news, and you see many people in a very bad situation. If you all the time you are in between with the others and you put yourself in their situation, you have to separate yourself again, because if all the time you are thinking about children without parents and people move from the place, people suffering. This picture, this bad picture, they said to save yourself. You have first. It's important to al-ittisal, to connect and to put yourself in their situation and to think about them and how can you help them. But it is very important in the same time to. Control yourself by disconnect or get out of this situation. Yes. Thanks a lot for you. That's what I want. Al-ittisal wal-infisal.
Absolutely. I will always remember this, Dr. Rita. Thank you for sharing this. And I think this is your explanation is brilliant. I absolutely agree with you. Thank you so much for doing this. Okay, so we'll move on from here, from EMIC and ethic, and let's now learn how to develop empathy. What is the best way of developing empathy? Now, I already have responses by grooming yourself, by having good communication, absolutely. I will move on from here, just in the interest of time. I have a very nice video, which is, we'll skip this slide, Ms. Fedha, and this slide as well, and this slide. Okay, let's go to the video now. So we will talk about, we'll watch a video. This video is about a group of students from Stanford University. I'm personally trained by Stanford University on the issue of empathy building and design thinking. And this group of students are also from Stanford University, and they experienced something, and that experience results in a big societal change. What I want everybody to do it, please watch this video carefully. There's a subtitle as well. You can read English subtitle, and if possible, take notes. Take notes on how do you think they build empathy, right? And what does that empathy result into? So take notes while you're watching this video. It's a beautiful video, and this is something that you will really like it. It's a case study, right? So please watch it, and then we will get back to this discussion. All right, so let's start.
This story begins 3 years ago when graduate students at Stanford University were assigned a class challenge: design an incubator that could save premature newborn babies in India, one that would cost less than $200 and help to solve the crisis of infant mortality in the developing world. More babies die here in India than in any other country in the world. In fact, nearly 2 million children under the age of 5 die in this country every year. Most of them live in poor neighborhoods like this one outside the city of Hyderabad. Most of the babies who die here don't even make it 1 month.
One of the biggest problems they face is simply staying warm, because these babies are so tiny, they don't have enough fat to regulate their own body temperature. 4 million of these babies die every year. The ones who do not die grow up with severe long-term health problems, because so much of their bodily functions are going towards staying warm that their organs don't develop normally.
Jane and her team traveled to India to see for themselves why the babies were dying. They learned that 80% of the tiny infants who need incubators only need them to keep warm, and most of them were in remote villages and in the urban slums, far from hospitals with the $20,000 machines.
By the end of the class, we knew we were onto something good. This is the most amazing team: a PhD in electrical engineering, an aerospace engineer, a master's in computer science, to have left behind what could have been far more lucrative careers to be saving babies.
We knew we had something that was immensely important, not only to us as a team, but also to the world.
The Stanford students now live in India. They have taken years fine-tuning the design of their cheap portable incubator. Dozens of models tried and rejected until this. It looks like a sleeping bag for newborns. It can be washed in boiling water. The inside is seamless so bacteria can't collect.
Hello there. This is a two-day-old baby. Oh, my goodness.
And the baby inside is kept warm by a plastic sheet containing paraffin wax.
And it's wax and water.
It actually probably feels a little bit like the womb, right?
It does. In fact, all the babies we've put into this have fallen asleep immediately. And
the wax is melted using an electric warmer where there's electricity, or simply by pouring boiling water on it. The wax is tucked in the back and will remain at 98 degrees for 4 hours and then can be reheated. All this for less than $200.
Hi, Munchkin. Hi there. He's sound asleep.
The culmination of 2 years of work, of hard work, of constant prototypes, and finally we have a product that is actually helping a newborn child, and it's unbelievable.
After 2 years on the drawing board, Jane and her team were finally ready to try their portable baby warmer on someone who needed it. Nisha, a 5-pound baby girl who was struggling to keep herself warm in a village in Bangalore.
The first time I saw a baby put in this, I just had chills down my spine.
Baby Nisha survived. She just turned 5 months old. Doctors at the Cradle Hospital in Bangalore have just finished the first round of tests on the Embrace baby warmer. A second and final set of trials are about to begin.
We're going to meet the highest quality standards. We're not bringing a second-rate product to developing countries.
What's been the reaction within the medical community to this device?
It's been incredible. And doctors are literally lining up to place orders for the product.
Clinics without incubators will use the baby warmers to move critically ill babies to city hospitals. Mothers in rural villages will use them to keep their underweight newborns warm and alive.
So how many babies' lives do you think you can save with this?
Over the next 5 years, we hope to save and help over a million babies.
And most of them will be from villages like this one, where Jane and the Embrace team have refined their baby warmer with the help of the mothers who will eventually use it.
Because in these villages, it's an everyday fact, right, that babies die. In fact, in many villages, you don't even name your baby for the first month of life.
Sudatha has lost all three of her newborn children. All were low birth weight babies. All died because they were too small to keep themselves warm.
The vision for me is that babies no longer die from being cold, that every rural clinic and every rural healthcare worker is equipped with the Embrace device.
Sudatha was shown the newest Embrace baby warmer, and soon other women from the village joined in. They too had lost children, they said. And within minutes, they were teaching each other how the baby warmer is used. If I had this, Sudatha said, I could have saved my babies. I could have had children. In March, the mass production of Embrace baby warmers will begin. India will be served first, and then the world.
There is a huge, huge global need for this, from Uganda, from Haiti, from Poland, asking, when can we purchase these? And hearing that just made me realize how close we are to fulfilling our mission, and to giving mothers a chance to save their children. And that's what drives me.
So you're going to change the world starting right here in India.
I hope so.
Wow, isn't it beautiful? Yeah, it's such a powerful case. And it's a real case. This students of Stanford University, they went. Okay, what I don't want to give you much explanation of this video myself. What I want you to do is that use this Mentimeter link and write here your responses on what were some of the examples of empathy did you identify? What is something that you observe in this video or you saw it in the video where you thought that, you know, this is what they did in order to build empathy? So Mira is saying in the chat box that they understood the pain of mothers went through when losing their children. Absolutely right, Mira. Yes, they felt the pain that, you know, what does it mean to lose a child, you know, just because that you don't have an incubator, you know, you can't afford to have an incubator, right? So they felt that pain. Okay, they felt the struggle. Absolutely. They understood the struggle people were going through, that, you know, newborn babies were born, but they didn't have money to, you know, have incubators. They didn't have electricity. It was too complicated to have incubators. So without incubators, there was, you know, premature death. So I think 4 million babies, if I'm not mistaken, please double check the number, but 4 million babies in the world die premature just because that, you know, many of them do not have access to those, the incubators, the machines which keeps you warm, right? When the child is born premature, like on the 7th month and 8th month, and then, you know, will have difficulty coping in the outside atmosphere, they need special kind of, you know, warmth and lights and all. So this is called, there's a machine called incubator. And that incubator provides that warmth, right? But because in villages, we don't have those machines, people used to lose their children. So 4 million children die every single year as premature death. So this is group of students, as Mira said in the chat box, they felt the pain that, you know, what mothers were going through. They saw how bad it was to lose a child from a cold, that they saved them as if they were their own children, right? So what did they do? So let's see the next question. Let's go to the next question. I'm surprised you are not able to write in the Mentee so much. If you are, please try. Feather is putting the link. It's very simple. Just go mentee.com and you will be able to put the passcode. She's already put there. And the, you know, and you will be able to see the question which you can start the answer. So what? Okay, so let's go to the next question. Ms. Feather, the next slide. So here, why was looking at empathy so important for them? Why do you think that, you know, it was so important to look at the empathy? Okay, Meera is saying to know the intentions of the students. Mm-hmm. And what did they do to build empathy? They sat in California, Palo Alto. Where did they sit? Where did they go to build empathy for these people? Were they sitting in their comfortable room in California and then, no, they went to a village in India, absolutely. Yeah, Meera is right. They moved, they sat, they went to India and stayed there for 2 years. They studied that what is going on? What is the problem? What do people go through? How do they feel when they lose the child? What are those pains, right? They went to village in India to build the empathy, to change the mindset. Okay, they were looking at the change mindset. What else? Yeah, okay, to bring the value of humanism, to help them, okay, to design something for them, to help them, absolutely, to help them improve their situation. Then how can we stop, you know, India being the largest country in the world, one of the largest countries where there's a highest number of premature deaths. So they left California, they left Palo Alto, they went to India in the village, they lived there for 2 years, they saw what was going on, they talked to parents, they lived there, and they understood the pain. And that's how they put the empathy. Yeah? Okay, so let's go to the next question. So what did they do? What did they do to meet the needs? They came up with a fancy $1,000 solution. What did they come up with? What was their solution? Okay, they did the research. Yes, they researched there. They lived in India. They studied there. They did the research, and they came up with, absolutely right, they came up with the portable incubators that were affordable, right? They invented an infant warmer device. Absolutely, yes, Siti. So they came up with a device which was suitable for that context. They came up with the you know, thing which you use the local material, stitch the local people, and that would serve the same purpose as to warm the babies. So a machine of $4,000, you know, would do. Now the locally stitched incubators would do. So I who live in village, I don't have a hospital, I don't have electricity, I don't have big machines, I don't have the knowledge to do it. I still can save the life of my child because I can use this simple $200, you know, solution in order to save the life of my child. So warms the babies, then they feel it was affordable. They came up with a solution which was affordable for them, low budget device to meet immediate needs. Absolutely, Prince, you are right. They came up with a low budget device. I cannot afford $4,000 solution. Even if I want to save my child's life, I cannot do it because I don't have money. I don't have electricity, I don't have machine. So they live there and they saw what is the strength of this Indian village woman. The strength was that they could stitch. The strength was that there was a material available. The strength was that, you know, everybody can afford to have this simple thing, the comforter that you saw, which will give the same warmth and lights to the babies, which saves people's life. What was the end result? The end result was, when they went to India, they lived there 2 years, they came up with design, they say it was successful, satisfaction, yes. What else was the result? It saved so many babies' lives. Thank you, Siti. It saved so many babies' lives, right? So look at the power of empathy. It saved so many babies' lives, okay? And that is what empathy is, and that is the power of empathy. Okay, we will do a small exercise. I know there are a few people who are very active, Siti, Usa, Mariam, Fatima. I really love what you're writing, Dr. Unida, all these people. I really would like to encourage others to participate in this activity. When I will explain to you, you will do it, and then I will ask you to unmute yourself and share. Right? You will talk. Okay. Now look at this picture. Observe everything that you see in this picture. Take 1 minute. Okay. Let's see everything here. You are able to, let's see it here. Try to observe as minutely as possible. Look at the top, look at the bottom, look at the sides, look at the shops, look at the women, look at the dresses, look at the floor, look at their entertainment. Yes, look at the panes and the windows and the curtains. I also see one dish antenna, by the way. I can see a couple of dish antennas here. But look at all these things very carefully. Observe very carefully. Okay, some people are writing poverty, small, poor society, pollution and all. Okay, I want to go to the next slide now and we will come back here. So let's go to the next slide for them. I want you to observe it in a way that imagine if you go to that situation. Imagine if you go to that place and you want to build empathy. You want to build empathy. What will be your questions? What will you ask them in order to understand their experience and their situation? Can you write it in on this Mentimeter, your questions? I want everyone to write at least one or two questions based on this picture. So look at this picture. Thank you, Feather, for putting this again. So look at this picture. Suppose you go there, like Stanford students, you go and live there for 2 years. Imagine, that's how empathy is built. So you go there and you want to understand the pains of the people. What questions will you ask to them? Can you look at the situation and see what questions would you like to ask to them? I already have questions in the chat box. You can write it in the chat box. I feel that this group is not very comfortable with Menti, and that's fine. Okay. Dr. Onida, if you can please unmute yourself. So Meera is putting a question. Can you afford basic utilities? Okay, this is one question. How can I help you? Maryam is saying. What do you do for a living? Okay. What do you do for a living? How can I help you? Okay. What are the other questions that you would ask? Write it in the chat box. If you go there and you want to build empathy, what questions will you ask? What do you suffer with the most daily? Okay. Okay, I have one question on the mentee. What do you suffer the most daily? Okay. Anything else? How can I help you? Fatima is saying, oh my God, I'm affected, but I will ask for health protection. No, I'm saying, you know, what question will you ask to build empathy? Okay, so somebody's saying, how do you live your daily life? Do you have enough resources to live? Can your house hold the whole family? Can your houses hold the whole family? Okay. If you could change one thing on your life, what would that good? Okay, what would you change? Thank you, Aya. That's a very, very important question. So Fatima, how can I help you? So the question to understand the situation better. That's what we are doing, right? So what kind of questions that you will ask in order to understand the situation better? Okay, Maryam is saying, are you under the care of a special doctor in terms of health? Does anybody take care of you? Fatima is saying, what is important thing that you need? Are you happy? Ayat is saying, somebody has written in the mentee, is that what recommendations could be given to a government to change this lifestyle? Okay, that's a very important question. Let's have two more questions and then we'll move on. Okay, no problem, no problem. You can write it in the chat box, Siti, no issues. I'm happy to read it in the chat box. Okay, any other question that you would like to ask? How do you live? Yes, Tanzil, good question. How do you live? Let's have one more question and then we'll move on. Anybody would like to go to the last question? Okay, yeah. So how do you manage? What is the most thing that you want to change? Do you get support from the government? Excellent, very good questions. Okay. Now I would like to go back to one empathy map. Yeah, this one, sorry. Yeah, this empathy map. And I will come back to this again. Okay. I want to teach you how to make empathy map, how to build empathy, okay? And then once you learn this, I will tell you my story as if I'm a part of that community in that place. And you, I will ask you to make your empathy map, okay? So when you make empathy map, this is empathy map. What you do is that when you interview people, when you talk to people, you try to put their responses in four different categories. What are they saying? What did the person say to you? You write it there. What does the person do? You write there. What does the person think? You write there. And what does the person feel? You write there. You try to separate four different buckets. You try to separate the responses in four different buckets. Like, for example, let's say you have got multiple colors of socks. You make red separate, yellow separate, green separate, blue separate, like this. Similarly, when somebody is giving you responses, you try to separate them into different categories in order to understand the pain points. All what we are learning here is how to understand the pain points, how to make it better, okay? How to build empathy. That's all what we are learning. So there are four categories that you will handle. Whatever the person is saying, you will write it under that category. Whatever the person is doing, you will write it in that category. Whatever person says that I think, you will write there. Whatever the person says I feel, you write there. So in order to do this, you will separate the communication or the interview or the story of a person into four categories. Are you all with me? Do you understand? Can I see a thumbs up in the chat box that you understood what I'm saying? Okay. So Sam is saying that he understood. Everybody else, can you show me quickly thumbs up in the chat box or just say yes or no? So I'm going to tell you my story as if I'm living in that condition. Okay, take a paper and a pen, make four columns. So make like this, the way you can see it on the screen, make four columns. Whatever I will say, you will put it in say column box. Whatever I do, you will put it in the do box. Whatever I think, you will put it in the think box. And whatever I feel, you will put it in the feel box. Fatima, I see your hand is up. You want to ask anything, Fatima? I can unmute yourself. You can speak now. Go ahead and speak. No? Okay. All right. So, So let's do this way. Okay. So, Miss Feather, if you can go to that picture again, that the poverty picture. And once, yeah, this one. So suppose I'm living in this place. I'm from this place, okay? And I will tell you my story now. And all what you will do is, you will write, what did I say? You will make this empathy map. Say, do, think, and feel. all these four sections, and that will be your empathy map. So we are learning here how to make an empathy map. Okay, so suppose you came to me and you ask all those questions that you asked, which you wrote in the chat box, and I'm telling you here. Okay, so I will act like as if I'm from there, okay? Are you ready? Take your paper and a pen and make your empathy maps. Okay. Our days are really difficult. We don't have any major source of income. Sometimes, you know, people give us food, so we eat. But overall, you know, and some of our children go to, you know, beg money. One or two people from this village, you know, they work outside, but the income is very low. Sorry, I think I'm going very fast, right? I'll go slow. Okay, because you need to write it in your box, in your empathy map. There are many other issues. People have health issues. There is not any form. We don't have any hospital here. We only treat the problems, health problems, with local resources that we have. Our children get often sick because the environment is very dirty. And I think government should do something, you know, to clean the environment at least here. I also think the government should, you know, have some job opportunities for us, for our people. Having a local community school will be a dream, that our children can go to school. And I think that there needs a health center, so children can be we can be treated in that health center. Sometimes we feel very sad. We feel very upset when we see, you know, we have dish, you know, now somebody, you know, we have got this dish antennas here, so we have some small TVs in our house. So when we see how people live outside, they have luxury, they live in such a lavish life, we feel very sad that some people have too much and we don't have enough basics. And I think this is a matter of concern. Okay, so I stop here and I want to give you some time. Whatever I said, you can make your empathy map. Let's take 5 minutes to do this. And then I will ask some of you to unmute yourself and share your empathy map with everybody. Okay, so let's take 5 minutes. You can make your empathy map, clean it up nicely, and you can do the way you like. So anyone who want to share, can you please raise your hand so I can unmute yourself and you can then share, you can talk your empathy map. Okay. Anybody who would like to share? Fatima, I see your hand is up, but your hand is up from before. So let me ask Hussam. Hussam has raised the hand. Yes, Hussam, you can unmute yourself now and you can share the empathy map. Then what did I say? What did I do? What do I do? What did I say that, you know, I think about, and what do I feel? Yeah, this one. Thank you, Amfeda. So let's share with us his empathy map with us. Okay, so quiet, please.
Okay, so in the what people say in the what people say box, I wrote what you said, that the life is really difficult and some people give you food and one or two people can walk outside and there are a lot of health issues and no hospitals to help you with that, and the environment is very dirty. And in the what people do a box, they you showed some sad faces, I can see. And then the think box, I can say that you thought of that the government should give people job opportunities and they maybe can put schools so that the children can get educated, and maybe a health center can help with the health issues. And in the what people feel box, you said that people are very sad and upset, and they feel, and they feel when they see the people on the TVs that some people have too much while they don't even have the daily resources. Like maybe they don't even have water while they watch on the TV that some people have luxury cars, maybe two or three cars and big houses, maybe even a castle.
Excellent.
Yeah, that's my empathy now.
Brilliant, Rusam. This was perfect. Very, 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 very well thought out empathy map. And very clearly, the say, think, and feel part was excellent. I feel a little bit more meat is needed in the do part, but let's hear from somebody else. If anybody else want to share and fill it more, and then we will understand that part as well. Anybody else would like to share with us the empathy map? Fatima, I'm not sure whether you want to speak because your hand is up and you are, you can speak if you want, you can unmute yourself and speak, but I see your hand is up. Okay, Fatima has put the hand down. Anybody else who would like to share and fill in what Usam just shared with us, the empathy map? One more person at least. I was very happy with what Usam said in that say, think, and feel sections. What about the do? What did I say that, you know, we do? Anybody can fill it in? What did I say I do? What did I say that, you know, when children are sick, what do we do? I said that, you know, we treat it with the local resources, remember? Yeah. So I think that is the part that you can add here. So otherwise, Usam, you've done a pretty good job, excellent job. And I think this is one of the tools, and there are many ways you can build empathy, but this is one of the ways you can, it's okay, Siti. It's one of the ways you can build empathy. So empathy is all about understanding the pain points of people, as we know, because that allows us to be able to understand the needs and be able to come up with innovative solutions. And that's exactly what we have learned here today. You cannot build empathy by sitting in a, you know, 50,000 feet, height. You have to live with people, be with people. And you know, when you build empathy, you become like a fly. You know how flies are? Have you ever experienced a fly irritating you while you are sitting or sleeping? You know, the fly, yes, yesterday, how annoying. Yeah, how annoying it is. Then, you know, you're sitting or you're sleeping and a fly is around you all the time. And that's exactly how we do empathy. We be like a fly on the wall, right? So you be around the person, on the person, here, everywhere, wherever possible, and try to understand what the person going through. And the art is in asking right questions, not one word answer. Are you happy? He will say yes, or he will say no. It doesn't give you anything. But tell me, how is your day? How is the whole day? How do you spend your life here? What are the major challenges you face here? So asking in the right questions is so important. You ask the right questions and then the person will tell you the story and use that story to make this empathy map. That map, this empathy map will help you to understand that what the person is doing. The person is relying on local medicine. That is something needs to be done for that. Or maybe there is no school, so something needs to be done there. Or there is no, jobs that people have. Everybody's, having a jobless. People go and beg, for example. Now, this is somewhere, these are the spots which will lead you to think about that something needs to be done in order to make their experiences better. Yeah. So in the last 1 minute, I want to say thank you so much for your active participation. I had a very, very good time. And I'm very happy to answer any questions that you have. And I love interacting with you. Please stay connected. You have got my details now in the brochure that you have received. Email me, connect with me, if anything. I'll be more than happy to talk with you on this topic. And thank you. And please feel free to ask questions. And if you have any question, raise your hand and I'll unmute yourself. Tanzeel, I see your hand is up and please feel free to unmute yourself and ask. Tanzeel, your turn. Thank you, Siti. This is a nice comment. I love it. Tanzeel, you wanted to ask a question because I saw your hand was up.
Yeah, can you hear me all?
Yes, I can hear you.
Thank you so much. It was a nice presentation, ma'am. I want to ask that. I think the map you made, you tell us to make, is it necessary to make that map?
So this map is one of the tools. There are many, many, many tools, and I didn't have time to teach you all the tools. I thought this is one of the tools which can help you understand how do you build empathy. But there are many, many ways you can do it to organize your data when you talk to people, to understand the pain points, and you can organize. It's just one of the ways of organizing the stories that you hear in your interviews.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Any other question anybody else want to ask before we close this? Thank you for the nice comments. I'm loving reading, Liddy, reading what you're writing. Thank you so much. I really like the empathy map. It can help someone to start off when they want to change something in society. Absolutely right, Usam. Siti is saying, I've enjoyed and learned a lot from you. Thank you so much, Jazakallah. Thank you for this nice comments. Thank you for your participation. And all the best to you. Enjoy your learning. And happy New Year. Happy holidays to everybody. Thank you. Take care of yourself. All right, so thank you for now and all the best to you.